morning. I wanted to joke with you, if you've just come in the auditorium, that I'm busy working on my sermon and that I'm actually writing it, but I thought that would be funny, except you may not think that was funny at all. And clearly you didn't, because you're not laughing. But this morning we go live with our online worship at 10 a.m. So we needed to do that anyway, even though you all were out in the commons area. And that actually, that was pretty cool, being able to converse with them in the online chat before our time in here started. You know, there's a lot of different things that you could have done today. It is New Year's Eve, and I guarantee you grocery stores are packed and people are out shopping and doing fun things in anticipating of the night of the year to ring in a new year. But you chose to come here. You chose to come to church, and you chose to watch online. So thank you. I hope that you find today meaningful and relevant. We are going to talk about the Netflix series that is based on a Pulitzer Prize novel called All the Light We Cannot See. Now, there are spoiler alerts in this, like you're going to know the plot of the movie, you're going to know how it works out, and I'm sorry for that. But I do think it will still be a powerful experience for you to watch it or read it. It's such a powerful story. It is about a young girl who is born blind, and it's her story, and it's how she maintains herself, her sense of identity throughout the World War II experience that she finds herself living in. She and her father have to flee their home, and some friends and family put them in, and the movie has this just overarching theme about light and darkness, and undoubtedly, we face that same theme in our lives. As we enter into a new year, you know, you see all the best of the previous year, like the best of 2023, and we look ahead to 2024. We think about the things that we want to accomplish, that we want to have happen in our lives, and there's such a thing. Dawn has been talking about an intention-setting ceremony with her yoga community, and next year, I'd love for her to lead us in one of those. It sounds like such a powerful experience, but you choose a word that is just going to be your focus word for the new year. So that's what the online community and I were talking about. What are some words that you want to define your life in the upcoming year? You know, they say that most New Year's resolutions, they don't last very long at all. And so most research says if you're going to have a resolution, just pick one. Don't try to do 10 things. Don't try to choose 10 different things that you're going to focus on. Just choose one thing. And don't set these lofty goals. Just take baby steps into that one thing so that you can achieve success. Tomorrow, and well, later today and then tomorrow, you're going to get some meditations through our emails. If you do not get our emails, we would love for you to receive them. We send out meditations that go along with the message series. And so I invite you to stop at the VIP tent out front, give Dawn your email address, and then we'll send those to you. We also put them out on social media. But we're going to send you some suggested intention setting words in hopes that you'll choose one to define your upcoming year. Now, next Sunday, we are going to start a new message series called The Chimp Paradox. At West, we try to do different kinds of message series. We do really deep Bible message series that we're focusing on scripture heavy. We did that back in the fall and then through the Christmas season. And so now we are going to try to tie in the way that we live our lives and the best way to put our best selves forward and deal with just normal life stuff and tie our faith into that. So that's what The Chimp Paradox is about. It is a book talking about how our chimp brains take over our lives and how we can learn to tame our chimp brain and truly live into being the best people that we can be, people at one. It does not talk about being at one with God, but we are going to talk about that and how we can peel away just all the stuff and the crap that happens in our lives and be true to who we are. So I hope you will be a part of that message series. And Easter happens really early in 2024, so we're going to go straight straight from that series into a series on the parables and the stories that Jesus taught when we begin Lent, which is in mid-February. So we're really excited about the new year and all the things that it holds. Now, as we get ready to dive into today's theme, light versus darkness, I invite you to take just a minute. I'm going to show you the trailer from the Netflix series, All the Light We Cannot See.
Ladies and gentlemen, before I begin my broadcast today, I have something to say.
In this time of darkness, of invading cities, I'm trying to remember. Light lasts forever. Darkness lasts.
Darkness lasts not even for one second.
When you turn on the light. I know that broadcasting could get me executed. But I will not be silenced.
I hope you will tune in again tomorrow.
When I was a child, I was trained to locate radio frequencies. The things that I've seen haunt me. The voice was my escape.
You are going to find her, and you will kill this girl yourself.
The Germans are close now.
All the people of the world have become evil at the same time.
Not all the people.
We need to not draw attention to this house. Marie won't be safe.
I will find your daughter.
If you fail, she will die first.
I think you know by now. You are sending messages that will help to win the war.
We cannot give up to these monsters. France does not belong to them.
Someone from our generation who thought, if you talk reason, then maybe the insanity of this war might come to an end.
I don't know how long I have, but I will remain here, where it all began.
This is where it ends.
Know you are out there. There is no escape.
The most important light is the light you cannot see.
So a big part of the series is addressing the issue of what drives us. Like what drives us to do the things that we do, to think the way that we think. And so one of the German leaders of the German regime, the particular, whatever they called it, the group that he was leading, he sort of goes off on his own tangent. He's looking for this rare diamond or rare gem that is supposed to have unique properties. And he believes, the wives' tale is, that if you have that stone, that if you touch that stone and you have it in your possession, first of all, if you touch it, misfortune is going to come to those who are in your life, to someone who is in your life. Misfortune is going to come, but you will live forever. So there's like stuff in there that we can unpack, right? Like he still wants the stone. He apparently has a debilitating illness that is going to take his life. And as the show goes on, you see that he is getting in worse and worse health. But he still wants the stone. He wants the stone for himself, even though his acquisition of the stone and his possession of it would only benefit him. He still wants it, even though he knows that once he gets it, misfortune would happen to someone that he loves. Now, we know that that's the exact opposite of being like Christ, the one that just a week ago we were celebrating the remembrance of his birth. And the awareness that the way that he lived and the way that he showed us to live, that in order to have life, it is making life not about us, but about others. But we're so human, and our human nature is to take care of ourselves first. That's why with the online community, while you all were still in the Commons area, we were talking about words of intention for the new year and picking a word and discussing words. And I talked about my word. I really feel like my word needs to be grace, because so many times I find myself in different situations and I either get defensive or because of past woundedness or whatever. And like I don't offer grace. And Jesus, in the Sermon on the Mount, when he gave, it was actually many little mini sermons, and he talked about all these different ways that in order to have true joy and pure joy from our souls, the way that we would do that would be to live in certain ways. And one of those is to always look at things from the perspective of the other people that we are engaged in. That's called mercy, giving mercy. And so, like, my word needs to be grace. But back to the movie, like, this guy, he wants the stone because it's going to help him live immortally. It will help him live forever. And so he believes that Marie, the young woman who is blind, he believes that she has the stone. Her father was a museum curator. And so back when the war started taking over that area, he had all the precious gemstones shipped to France. And then they fled the country. And so the German soldier thinks that Marie knows where the stone is or has the stone, and that if he can get the stone from her, his life will be saved. So that's like the plot of the movie or the show. But as all that transpires, like it comes back to this radio. And there's this other character in the series. His name is Werner, and he was an orphan and a brilliant young boy. And in the orphanage, he was just fixated on radios. And so he has this uncanny ability of fixing them. And so, like, at one point in the movie, the Nazis take him and they're like, you know, we need a radio transmitter fixer. And so they have him in a room with other people, and within like 30 seconds or something, he fixes the radio. And so they need it to understand what the enemy is going to do. They need it to communicate amongst themselves. So the radio is an important part of the movie as well. The really powerful thing, though, is in England and in France and throughout Europe, messages of hope were also sent out on the radio. And so there was this guy named the Professor, and every night he would teach lessons throughout the radio waves that they would listen to. And then, once he stops transmitting, then Marie takes over. And ultimately, what she is doing with the messages that were written to given to her is that she's sharing secret things for the Allied forces so that they could come and help win the war. But the voices that come over the radio, they're really important. And so that's another question that I have for us today. Like, what voices do you listen to? Because believe it or not, those voices play such an important part in our relationship with light and darkness. My hope for each of you would be for 2024 that it is a year of light and a year of life. The two things go hand in hand. And so the question that we have to ask ourselves in order to get to that new year and that new year that's full of light and life is, what keeps us from it? So the voices that we listen to, the voices that are audible around us, you know, not everybody wants you to be successful. Sometimes, and this is something that they teach in therapy, like if you become better, if we become better in our own selves and become more healed and whole individuals, those that are used to us not being healed and whole, they don't like it. It's uncomfortable for them. And sometimes, unfortunately, we are surrounded by people with toxic behaviors. And so as we heal and become whole, did you think about Jesus? Like when he started his public ministry, the people that should have received him and welcomed him first wanted him killed. They're like, who the heck does he think he is? He's nobody. Like when he went back to Nazareth for his first message, they ran him out of town. Now, Jesus could have listened to those voices, and he could have allowed them to cause him to stop doing his ministry. But instead we read in Scripture that he wiped the dust off his feet and he kept going. And thank goodness that he did, because a couple of thousand years later, we have this beautiful picture of what life can be amidst the darkness. One of the quotes in the movie is about how, you know, and you saw it in the trailer, darkness does not exist even for a second once you turn the lights on. It's a powerful idea. So I'm asking you this morning, like, what voices do you listen to? What things do you let control you that cause us, what things do we let control us that cause us to stay in darkness instead of living in light? I want to show you one of the quotes from the series. Your problem isn't how to get out, it's how to get in. We live in such a constant society, a constant culture. Everything is fast, everything is immediate, and with the new introduction this past year of AI into our world, like, things are even more fast and more automatic than they've ever been. But working through our own stuff, there's nothing fast and automatic about that. It seems like AI can do almost everything, you know, except it can't heal our souls. And whether we want to admit it or not, we all need a little soul healing. And what better day to do that than on New Year's Eve? So how are you willing to heal your soul? You know, like, we got to go in. And one of the beautiful messages that Jesus taught is that what we need lies deep within us. It's our soul. It's the presence. We call it the Holy Spirit that abides in each of us. There's a voice that is inside of each of us. It's just up to us to listen, to be in tune to that. And in order to do that, we have to tune out all the negative voices, the toxic voices, the energy vampires that we have in our lives. And focus on and listen to the things that are whole and pure and bring us light and life. I want you to take a look at another quote. The brain is locked in total darkness, of course, children. It floats in a clear liquid inside the skull, never in the light. And yet the world it constructs in the mind is full of light. Think about that for just a second. Like our brains, that's what constructs this stuff. It's never exposed to the light. Like it exists within our heads. But it can compose just the most beautiful light and experience. It's easy for that to happen when everything's going well. So I love that the main character of this book and of this show, like, she's blind. What deters you in your life? Like, what gets under your skin and annoys you and stops you from doing the things that you think you're going to do or that you had planned to do? Basically, I'm asking, you know, like, what's your resilience level and what's your grit? Those could be powerful words for 2024 if you find yourself answering like, well, I'm easily deterred. Tom and I were joking this morning. We were talking about like 2024 and intentions. And I'm like, you know, I am trying to be more intentional about being healthy and like not going to the gym once every 2 or 3 months. Once every 2 to 3 months does not bring about successful results. And he's like, well, Andrea, I love you, but the only person that can control that is you. And look, if there's even like a slight cloud in the sky, I will let that be my excuse not to go to the gym, you know, because I don't want to, you know, be in negative weather. And I don't really even care about weather. What I'm saying is like I find excuses to not do the things that I don't really want to do, but I know that are important. So what things are important to you? What are the things you need to focus on? And then how often and how quick do you let yourself get pulled away from those things? How often and how much do we allow ourselves to be overwhelmed? It's interesting. If it's work-related, I have more resilience and more grit than anything. Because I'm passionate, like I'm passionate about West and I'm willing to do whatever and work however much and blah, blah, blah. But if it like comes to my personal health and my personal well-being, I have the resilience of like a negative 10. I'm so easily deterred. And you know what? Work-life balance, those two things go together and they're important. What about you? Are you taking care of yourself? What do you need to do so that 2024 is a year of light and life? Are you willing to dig in and go deep and confront the things that distract and deter you? I want you to take a look at this next quote. Time is a slippery thing. Lose hold of it once, and its string might sail out of your hands forever. We think we have all this copious time, and then, like, we don't. Hours turn into days, and days, weeks, weeks, months, and then we're like, oh my gosh, where'd the year go? Do you find yourself thinking that? Like, where did time go? What if in 2024 we lived as people that like we make each day matter? Going back to the gratitude idea that I was talking with the online community about before you guys got in the auditorium, like gratitude, you hear about gratitude journals. That's more than just writing down, well, I'm thankful that, you know, it was a pretty day. I'm grateful that I had a good day at work. That's not gratitude. I'm grateful that we were able to have an impromptu meeting that was going to lay out the next 6 weeks. That's gratitude, despite all the other things we had on our agenda. I'm grateful that I had a text from someone that I was not expecting today, and it really brought some joy into my life. Those specific things, that's gratitude. I heard years ago something that said, the way to keep life from just happening is to make things happen that are distinct, to break the routine. That if we break the routines that we have in our lives, then we create memories and we make things memorable. And then it makes time feel like it doesn't just pass so quickly by. So in 2024, what if we are intentional about our time? What if we don't let it slip out of our hands? What if we acknowledge the things that we have in and through our lives? And what if we're grateful for them? I try to practice what I preach. I don't do it as much as I should this morning. You know, I think all these things all the time, and then I don't take the action to, like, actually put the action into words this morning. And I do if, like, I think there's room for improvement. But the things that I'm grateful for, I'm like, they know. This morning I was sitting at the stoplight ready to turn onto Dooley Road to come here from the office, and our flags were out. And the flags, like, they look amazing. We redid the flags when we reopened after the pandemic, and they actually talk about our children's ministry, and it talks about fun on a flag on 150. And then it talked about our worship, and it had our logo. And in that moment, I was grateful for all those things. And I was actually really grateful for the person who puts the flags out. I think that is like the most thankless job ever, but such an important one. And the way that they put the flags out. So like when you're sitting there at the stoplight, you know, if they were all like lined up parallel with one another, you wouldn't see them. But the way that the flags were so particularly placed, it made me want to come to West. I'm like, oh, they have a kids ministry. That's fun. And then they have worship at a high school. That sounds pretty non-threatening. And so I actually like took that next step this morning and I said, hey, I just want to tell you, Jay, the flags look great today. How many people in your life do you need to just take that extra step and tell them thank you? Tell them that what they do matters. Those things matter. And every time we say those things, like we are marking moments in time, not just for ourselves, but for them. And believe it or not, we are bringing light into their life. Words punch holes in people's darkness. What words can you share with other people in 2024? And now I want to show you this quote. A man who is always fighting darkness is never far from light. A man who is always fighting darkness is never far from light. If any quote in this show talks about Jesus, this one resonated. Think about his life. Like, it was not easy. His 3 years of public ministry were riddled with scrutiny, ridicule, testing. I mean, that's how it started, like even with the ultimate test from God, like, let's see where your resilience and your grit really is, Jesus. I think sometimes we think as people of faith that it ought to just be easy. That if we follow Jesus, it's like the cushiest ride ever because we're Christian and we're good people. There is nowhere in there in the Bible, in Holy Scriptures, that those things, like, are said. And the one that we choose to follow and model our lives after and try to be like and let his presence live within each of us, his life was anything but cushy and easy. But the one thing that his life showed us is that despite the darkness that we fight around us, light always wins. I want to show another clip from the show. This is the like one of the end scenes, and it just shows you all of the darkness. Take a look.
You are the professor.
I am a soldier. You are a soldier. Nothing before matters. So.
So?
He's young. He's a radio operator. His name is Vernon.
We don't care about names.
He was taken from an orphanage against his will and made to join a signals regiment.
How many men, women, and children have you killed?
My job was to locate radios that were transmitting messages.
And when the radios were located?
Just give us a rough estimate. How many men, women, and children have you killed?
Sir, you said I could finish my story. Please, I want to explain what happened.
We know what happened!
Our comrades in Normandy and Belgium told us what happened. Anyone found with a radio was executed by members of your regiment. Their families executed with them. Their neighbors executed. Men, women, children, executed.
He was just engaged in finding frequencies.
Professor, please.
Professor.
We're not interested in what you have to say, German.
We don't have the capacity to keep prisoners either.
I would take care of him.
He's not your child.
Take care.
I mean, take responsibility.
Why? Why would you do that?
The verdict is simple.
Please,
the sentence is
death.
Which one of us is going to carry out the sentence?
I will. I will shoot him in my own
No,
hand.
No, 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 no.
That was not a bomb from a plane.
No, that was artillery. American artillery.
Coming. It's finally coming.
Etienne, move!
He is good!
He is the enemy! Now stand aside!
Stand aside, Etienne! Etienne! Now!
No! I have wasted half my life hiding from my fears. You must be fearless.
Etienne, I won't tell you again.
Stand aside, Etienne.
Boy.
Etienne.
I am the professor.
Marie?
I won't tell you again.
No, you are up there, Marie.
Now listen to me as you once did.
Stand aside.
There is no escape.
Run.
So freedom for them comes amidst a lot of darkness. Those that are close to darkness are also never far from light. And we saw that in the way that Jesus lived. And so in 2024, if you find yourself facing darkness, I want you to remember that regardless of what darkness may come at you, light always wins. There's one more quote that I want to show you from the book and the show. Open your eyes and see what you can with them before they close forever. I debated using that quote this morning because I'm like, you know, it's sad. Open your eyes and see what you can with them before they close forever. And then I realized that actually, yeah, it's the perfect quote with which we end today's message, because it isn't true. Open our eyes and see what we can with them while we're in the here and now. But as followers of Christ, the one thing that we hold on to is that darkness never, ever wins. And our eyes, they will never close forever. Death, physical death, human death, brings about like transition into a different realm, an eternal realm. But we aren't gone. The loved ones that have gone before you, they aren't gone. They're different. In 2024, live with your eyes open. Mark your moments. Be intentional with your words, remembering that words punch holes in other people's darkness. And remember that we are children of light. In 1 John, we hear these words. From the very first day we were there, taking it all in. We heard with our own ears and we saw it with our own eyes. We verified it with our own hands. The word of life, they're referring to Jesus, the word of life appeared right before our eyes and we saw it happen. And now we're telling you this in most sober prose, that what we witnessed was incredibly this, the infinite life of God himself, the infinite life of God, God's self, took shape before us. We saw it, we heard it, and now we're telling you about it so you can experience it along with us. This experience of communion with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. Our motive for writing is simply this. We want you to enjoy this too. Your joy will double our joy. This, in essence, is the message we heard from Christ and are passing on to you. God is light, pure light, and there is not a trace of darkness in God. Yesterday afternoon, I had the privilege of officiating a wedding for a couple that were going to get married at a local wedding venue, and because I'd done previous weddings there, the venue coordinator gave them my name. They interviewed me, which I took delight in, because I'm glad that they took the religious part of their day very seriously. He grew up United Methodist, she grew up Catholic, so they were trying to find a balance, and they chose me. I thought it was interesting, you know, that they were getting married on the 30th, you know, right before the new year. As I stood there with them, you know, in the specialness of those moments and the beauty of all the faces surrounding them and that special moment of covenant, like it was just one of those warm and fuzzy moments. And I thought, how cool that this is how they're going to start their new year in a new place, a new chapter, a journey as husband and wife. I was struck by the beauty and the light of that moment. Then I drove home and I got home and, you know, Tom's not a chit-chatty kind of guy. He is an introvert. I'm an extrovert to infinity. And so when I walk in and I hear him audibly on the phone, I'm always actually happy. I'm like, oh, cool, he's chit-chatting with somebody. He had them on speaker and they were just talking and I didn't really know the voice on the other side of the line. I just assumed it was one of Tom's friends, and they were just talking, and then Tom brought me into the conversation with him, and I've not met him. It's actually one of Tom's friends from high school. We're in our 50s, our mid to late 50s, so that was a few days ago. His friend moved from northern Illinois down to Charlotte. Is now working here, he and his wife, and their kids have now moved to North Carolina as well. I got to hear this man's voice, and I was just struck by how happy he sounded. I'm like, oh, cool, they're catching up. They were making plans to get together and inviting us and that kind of stuff. I was like, oh, what a cool day for Tom to be able to connect with his friend. And I was just sort of caught up in the warm fuzziness of the wedding and then the happy thoughts of Tom connecting with a friend. And when Tom got off the phone, he's like, that was Gary. And I remembered who he was talking about, you know, his high school friend that moved to Charlotte. And they've not seen each other since, like, I mean, it's been over 30 years. Until they reconnected in Charlotte about a year or two ago. They were making plans to connect again. And then Tom said, his wife has stage 4 lung cancer. And I just was struck by that. Because the voice on the other side of the phone did not sound to me like someone connecting with an old dear friend and telling them that their wife had stage 4 lung cancer. She was diagnosed back in March. And has been undergoing treatment ever since. The voice on the other side of the phone was one of peace. And that just sort of sat with me throughout the evening and this morning. 2024, ringing in the New Year's Eve and a new year. To be able to go at that with that kind of heaviness, being present in one's life, but to be able to do it with such a voice of peace. Tom told me later on, he said, you know, he just kept telling me how grateful they are. Think about that. Grateful. And that their days are marked with gratitude. Faith is a big part of who they are and how they live. That's the kind of difference faith makes in punching holes in darkness. I hope 2024 for each of you is a year of light amidst darkness. Let us pray. Gracious God, you are the giver of light and life. And you show us that no matter how dark things may seem, we are just a breath, a thought away from being fully encompassed in light. Thank you for being a God of light and life. Thank you for the one who came so unassumingly thousands of years ago and showed us what it means to be a person of light and life. May we all commit ourselves to 2024, being intentional and mindful and present and living as people of light, so that we may be instances for others punching holes in their darkness. We offer ourselves to you in Christ's name. Amen. Thanks for coming today. I hope you have a great New Year's Eve. Stay safe, and I will see you next Sunday. Thanks.